And then you have to click again there, and then you'll be able to.
Yeah, I understand. Hello, everyone. Today, Chunting and I will introduce the models with latent random variables. Before we actually get started, I want to first distinguish the difference between the discriminative and the generative models. The discriminative model actually calculates the probability of the output of the given input. And just as you did in the assignment one, you create a CNN classifier and the input is a sentence. The output is a classification label. This is a typical discriminative model. But a generative model instead calculates the probability of the data of X or both X and Y. Like the LSTM language model is a generative model because it models the PX distribution. So there are three typical cases. The first is by LSTM post tagger. It's discriminative because the input is sentence, output is a post text. The second is a CRF model. CRF models a conditional probability, so it's also discriminative. And the language model is generative, just as I mentioned. There are also different types of variables. Observed variable often refer to the observed data, which is our data. And the latent variable often refer to the variable that we assume exists, but actually we are not given the value. And there are also deterministic and random variables. Actually, in our, like in your experiments in assignment one, most of the variables are deterministic because in the neural network, every variable is computed by a deterministic function. You have a fixed, you have a deterministic output given an input. And also there, another class of variable is random. This variable follows a probability distribution. And so it's a stochastic. Okay, so here is a little quiz about which variable is observed or latent or deterministic or random. So the first input word ID is observed and deterministic, right? Second, the encoder hidden states is latent. Yeah, right, deterministic. And attention values, latent, yeah, deterministic. And the output words ID? Yeah, this one is kind of tricky. This one is kind of depends. During training time, you observe the output. So it's observed and deterministic. But at the decoding time, you don't observe the output, and you actually want to predict the output. You predict the output to follow some like softmax distribution. So in the decoding time, it's actually latent and random. Yeah. OK, so let's get started to latent random variable model. The goal of this kind of models is to specify the structure relationship behind the data and to inject inductive bias and some prior knowledge. These sentences might read very difficult, but in the rest of lecture, it would become more clear how these models achieve these goals. For example, a class of older latent variable models can actually inject the structure to learn some interpretable structure, for example, the topic model. The topic model can learn topic semantics in an unsupervised manner, which is we don't have topic labels. It's harder to imagine in the current like LSTM or CNN to learn some interpretable semantics without labels, right? Because in current, in the most work you have done, maybe, if you want to learn some interpretable structure, you need to depend on the labels, like the classification label or some like tree structure label. You need labels, and you use these labels to supervise the neural network to output the structure. But for topic model, it's fully unsupervised. This is because we have the latent random structure. And another example is a hidden Markov model. Hidden Markov model can be used as a unsupervised tagger to tag as a part of speech post tags. And there are also some tree structured model. All of these models are random variable and they are stochastic. And the tree structured model can be used to do unsupervised parsing. But these topics are actually very old. These related papers are from a very long time ago. So why do we need to specify the structure? and to do that, why do we need the latent random variable? That's because in practice, most human interpretable structure is actually discrete, like the dependency parsing, semantic parsing, like post-text, all of this like human interpretable structure is discrete. And it's hard to model discrete structure with deterministic variables, right? Because if you use, of course, in some special cases you can model the output like this one. This is the input, and the output is discrete, it can be something like this. Yeah, but you have such functions, this is deterministic, but the gradient, there is no gradient for this, right? This point is not differentiable, and this point of the gradient is zero, so you can't optimize this kind of function with the gradient optimization method. So the common practice is to use discrete variable, like is to model discrete variable as a random variable to follow some like a categorical distribution, and we use some neural network or function to parameterize the parameters of that distribution. And the second point is actually very interesting. I want you to know that there is always a trade-off between the interpretability and the flexibility. So why is that? A simple example is there are many factors behind the data, like the language. There is post-text, syntax, semantics, and all of these factors. And we can use a very powerful neural network like LSTM, which is very powerful, so it can theoretically capture all of these aspects, but it's not interpretable since all of these aspects interact with each other and into those uninterpretable scalar values in this neural network. Yeah, but actually, if we want to learn interpretable structure, we want to disentangle this, for example, dependency parse from the other parts. In this case, we want to add some structure constraint into this model. Upon we add this constraint, we actually limit the model's capacity. Because for LSTM, like, we don't care what structure it is in the LSTM, we just care it fits the data very well. But if we want to add a structure constraint, we limit the capacity, so the flexibility is actually sacrificed. This is a trade-off between interpretability and flexibility. And in current, the deep learning field, the most popular latent random variables, latent random variable models are actually the deep latent variable model. There are mainly three classes. The first is the variation autoencoder, which we will focus on today. The second is GAN. I think most of you have heard about that. And the third is less popular, which is called a flow-based generating model, but it also has its own advantages and it has very good performance. And today in this lecture, we are going to focus on variation autoencoders. So what's a variation autoencoder? The model part is actually very simple. And just as shown in this figure, we observed the output x, and we have a latent variable z generated from a prior, say, Gaussian like a predefined Gaussian distribution. And we have a function f, just map each z to x. So the model is just like this. And the learning parameters is the parameter for f. So we want to learn a function f that tries to map a Gaussian distribution to our data distribution, just as shown in this figure. The left part is the z. There are many points in this prior distribution. They are distributed following approximately to Gaussian. And for each data point, we have a f function to map this point to data point. And our data distribution might be very weird and a very abnormal distribution, just like this case, it's a circle. And even in some cases, it can be rectangle, something like that. And our goal to learning VAE is to learn such mapping, to map each point in this Gaussian space to a data point in our data space. This is the goal to learn VAE. And I also want you to think this question not only about point mapping. It's more about distribution mapping. The left part is a Gaussian distribution. The right part, while we observe many data points in practice, but there is actually a data distribution, but we don't know that. This is our goal. We learn language model to model that data distribution. There is a distribution here, and our VAE is to learn this mapping that maps the Gaussian to the data distribution. Okay, so how to learn this model? Remember how to learn the LSTM language model? We observe X, and we just maximize the log likelihood of the model distribution on that X. This is a maximized likelihood estimation for the parameter. We also use this way to learn the VAE, but it's much harder. Why? Because we have the random latent variable, that's Z. In language model, it's easy because we don't have the latent random variable Z, so we can compute the closed form for the PX, so we can just optimize that with gradient optimization. But for this case, as shown in this similar, we have to compute the integral over the random variable Z to compute the marginal data likelihood. But this term is intractable. You can imagine we have a F function, which is a complex neural network. This function can't be, like the second integral can't be computed in a closed form. So we can also, and of course we can approximate this integral by sampling. But to reach a very accurate approximation to the PX, we have to do a lot of samples. Like we have to sample Z from the prior again and again, maybe thousands of samples, just to do one gradient, just to do one gradient optimization step. So that's actually very inefficient and not accurate. So this is why VAE appears. Actually, before VAE appears, I would introduce variational inference. This is why variational inference is a very old topic, but this is why there is a word variational in VAE's name. This is called a variational inference. So instead of optimizing the marginal likelihood in the previous slides directly, we optimize its lower bound. The variational inference basically derive a lower bound, which is called elbow, to lower bound the marginal data likelihood. The lower bound is written as this form. If you read the material, you should know this form. The first term is the reconstruction loss. The reconstruction loss is basically the objective to train a purely like a vanilla autoencoder, not a variational autoencoder. The second term is new for the VAE, is a KL divergence between the Q distribution and the prior. KL is kind of the distance to measure the kind of a distance metric to measure the distance between distributions. So KL, the second term can be viewed as a KL regularizer. And note that we introduce a new distribution, Q. The Q doesn't appear in the model. The model only has P, right? The model, this F function is actually the conditional probability, which is PX given Z. But we don't have Q in this model. In this lower bound, we actually provide a new distribution, which is called the variational distribution, Q. Actually, Q can be anything. You can specify Q as any distribution, and this inequality would hold. The inequality holds for any Q, but the lower bound is tight only if the Q Z given X is equal to PZ given X, but PZ given X is also intractable. So this is why we have Q. We actually want to Q to approximate the PZ given X. If the approximation is accurate, so this lower bound is tight. If this lower bound is tight, when we update this lower bound, we actually update the marginal data likelihood. Okay, there is a small practice, like prove this equation. I'm not going to prove this equation here. Actually, I just want you to know proving this equation is not hard. The hint is to use Jensen's inequality. Maybe you can just use like three steps to derive this lower bound. It's not, maybe the equation seems like a complex equation, but the derivation is actually not hard. If you are interested, you can try later. Okay, variational autoencoder. Variational autoencoder appears in 2014. But a variational inference is a pretty old topic. So why is variational autoencoder so successful? Because it uses the neural network. It uses the inference, which we also call encoder. It uses a neural network to parameterize the Q function. Before the variational autoencoder appears, people often use separate parameters for each data point to model its Q distribution. But the neural network, you can just have one neural network and model the Q distribution for all of the data points. It's like for each data point, we just input this data point to this encoder, and the encoder would output the parameters for this posterior distribution Q. So actually, VAE is more like an efficient method to train this kind of model. The model is not novel. This generating model has appeared very long ago, just before the VAE appears. So VAE becomes very successful, just it's a very efficient method and a very stable training method to train this kind of model. It's kind of a new training method, but currently, in current literature, people just refer the whole structure, encoder, decoder, and prior, people just refer the whole structure as the VAE method. But actually, it's more like a training method. Okay. We can view a much simpler view to view this VAE objective is to view it as the regularized autoencoder, because the separation of the objective is very clear. The first objective is a reconstruction loss. It's just a reconstruction, right? If you train a autoencoder without the prior, it's just this objective. But VAE only adds an additional KL regularizer to this objective. It's pretty like a regularized autoencoder. From this view, this understanding for VAE becomes much simpler. But why we need this prior? Yeah, I think this is an important question to think about. Now that we have the autoencoder, why do we need a variational autoencoder? Why do we need to add that regularizer to the autoencoder objective? Why don't we just delete the regularizer term and just delete the prior, and we just do an encoder decoder structure, just train with reconstruction loss? We can still do reconstruction, we can still do representation learning, right? Why do we need this prior? I think this is an important question to consider the importance of VAE. Okay, I will give the example to clarify the difference between VAE and AE. AE is the autoencoder. The first example is a VAE. We have the prior, we have the KL regularizer. So that's after training, our Z space, like when I say Z space, I mean if we sample Z given one X input from the encoder, like for many X points, for many data points, we sample many Z points. And for VAE training, the Z would follow like the Gaussian distribution, just like showing this figure. This is actually inductive bias. This is why I mentioned the inductive bias in the beginning of this lecture, that latent random variable can add inductive bias. This is one way to add inductive bias through the predefined prior distribution PZ, because we actually want the latent space to behave like a Gaussian. So it's finally trained to behave like a Gaussian. But for autoencoder, there is no any regularizer towards this latent embedding space. So what would it look like? There is actually also a PZ here. Because if you view data population as a distribution, there is always a distribution for Z. There is also a PZ, but we don't know what a PZ is. And for VAE, we know PZ is a Gaussian, but for autoencoder, the PZ might be some very weird distribution, like in this case, the circle. And I want to ask a question here. Do you think the autoencoder is a generating model or not? Generating model or discriminative? Generative? No. Autoencoder is actually a discriminating model. Why? There are two reasons. You can think of as two. The first, can you really generate unseen data from autoencoder? No, right? Because you can't sample Z from PZ. You don't know what PZ is. The only thing you can sample Z is from X. But by that process, you are actually doing the reconstruction, right? It's not sampling. If we want to sample, there is no way for autoencoder to sample new data point. But for variational autoencoder, you can just sample Z from the Gaussian distribution, and you decode, you get a new data point. Right, so it's not generative. And the second, remember how we define generating model. Generating model can output the log likelihood for a new data point. VE can do that because VE can output the lower bound of that log likelihood. But autoencoder is not right. Autoencoder cannot output the probability or likelihood for a new data point. If given X, I ask you, what's the probability of X? You can't answer me with the autoencoder model, right? These are two reasons. So autoencoder is a discriminating model. Okay, this is the basic knowledge about VAE. So why VAE? VAE is important for generating modeling, and VAE is important for representation learning, and VAE also provides a flexible choice to regularize this representation space by specifying some prior. And another important part is that VAE can be learned without any labels. This is a generating model. This is an unsupervised framework. We can just train VAE on the raw text and learn representation and model the distribution. Okay, let's compare. This is a VAE and AE, I think it's very clear. AE is not a generating model, and AE cannot control the representation space, but it's also unsupervised learning. So how about LSTM LLM? Okay, first is of course generating model, right? Representation learning, do you think? LSTM LLM, LSTM language model. Okay. My answer is yes too. And unsupervised learning, yes, right. Controlled representation space, no. And another example is about like your implemented assignment one, the CNN or RNN classifier, generating model,
no.
Okay. Representation learning, yes. Yes, of course, right, because you learn the sentence embedding for classification. Unsupervised learning, no. Control, no. This is the advantage of VAE framework. Okay, next time we'll introduce like learning VAE. Notice that in this framework, to learn the VAE, we have to calculate the expectation, like the reconstruction loss. People always do sampling, right? Sample Z from encoder. Yeah, but sampling breaks the backpropagation, right? How did you propagate the gradients through samples? Right, it's hard. But the VAE paper actually plays a very clever trick, which is called the reparameterization trick. I guess you already know. It's just by sample from Gaussian distribution, we can just write this sampling as a computation graph, which has a sample from a sample from a noise vector from the normal distribution, and multiply with the variance and plus the mean vector, which are the output from the encoder. So in this way, this is actually a whole computation graph. You can just do end-to-end training to optimize this objective. Yeah, but note that it's not every distribution can be applied to reparameterization check. This trick is only applied to a very limited categories of distributions. Gaussian is the most common, and some other continuous distribution is also feasible. But for discrete distributions, I think it's unfeasible to use this trick. So people always use like reinforcement learning to approximate the gradients. Yeah, that's another class of models. Okay, next I will give an example to actually apply. This is the first paper to apply VAE in our field to generate sentences. Remember when we generate when we generate from language models, we just sample the start symbol and just sample the next words, and we generate a sentence. But in VAE, this paper is called generating sentences from a continuous space. Because our latent space is continuous, is a Gaussian random variable, and we generate the sentence from a Gaussian variable. In other words, it's like each data point, each discrete sentence data point corresponds to one continuous data point in this Gaussian space. Yeah, this is why it's called generating sentences from a continuous space. Basically, the VAE is conditioned on Z, and the decoder is an LSTM to generate sentences. Encoder is also an LSTM to encode the sentences. So this is this model. And the results is pretty impressive. We can see the generator, like this is a linear interpolation between two sentences. Let's first look at the right part. This is output from VAE. The bodied text are the sentences in the in our data set. The way it does interpolation is that for data point x, and for data point x1, in this case, it's I want to talk to you. And for data point x2, in this case, it's she didn't want to be with him. And we map, and we use the encoder to map these two data points to the latent space, which is Z1 and Z2. and next we do linear interpolation. Like there is a linear 9, and we select another point in this ring to this linear space, and we give it to the decoder, and we generate it to this. And actually these sentences are different, like interpolated points here and generated to a new data point. We can see that these sentences is kind of transfer from one to another, but the most impressive part is that the middle sentences are all fluent. They are all like English sentences. They follow the grammar rules. But in contrast, for AE, for autoencoder, for the autoencoder without that regularizer, we can do the same linear interpolation. But in the middle point, the generated sentences is just not fluent, and it doesn't follow the like English grammar rules. So anybody knows why? Okay. Anybody knows why from this figure? Okay, I will explain. For the VAE, say our latent distribution is a Gaussian. And if for any data point, we encode to Z1 and to Z2, and we do linear interpolation, right? Say this ring. This ring is still in the Gaussian space, right? This is a convex set. It's still in Gaussian space. This is why for linear interpolation, it's still decodes to fluent sentences. But for autoencoder, say our distribution is kind of like weird distribution like this, maybe this. Say if our autoencoder, the distribution is this, say our Z1 is here, our Z2 is here. If we do linear interpolation, like this ring is actually outside of this space, right? For any point outside of this space, if we input that to the decoder, the decoded point is not in our data distribution, so it's not a fluent sentences. This is why we need this regularizer. It actually regularizes the prior space to kind of a convex set, but for this one, actually the practical case for this distribution might be much more complicated and weird than what I plotted here. Yeah. Okay, there is an example online for the VAE language model, this paper. Okay, next I will give time to Chun-Ting to introduce the VAE applications.
So next I will talk about some training problems in VAE and Then I will talk about how to handle discrete latent variables and talk about some applications of variational inference that are applied in natural language processing. So first, there is a notorious problem of training in VAE, which is called a posterior collapse. So posterior collapse means so the model totally ignores the latent variables Z and just rely on the decoder itself to generate the outputs. So the latent variable Z could become independent from the our input X, and it's well aligned with the prior PZ, which is just a simple standard Gaussian distribution. And when this happens, so the model cannot learn informative latent variables Z. So several explanations have been proposed to explain why this happens and how to alleviate this problem. So first, the first solution is KL divergence annealing. So the basic idea is the KL divergence term is relatively easy to learn compared to the encoder-decoder model, which requires informative latent variable, latent representation of Z. And so a straightforward and simple solution to this problem is we can anneal the KL divergence cost. We can gradually increase the weight of this KL divergence cost from a small value to one gradually at a warm-up period. So at the beginning stage of the training, the model can learn more about the encoder-decoder set instead of focusing on the KL divergence term. And when the model can learn some more informative latent representations of Z, then the model can rely on the regular latent term of KL divergence to make the posterior look more like the prior we specified. But this model cannot, it is shown that this technique cannot solve the posterior collapse problem when the model is equipped with more stronger like RSTM decoder for text or more stronger decoder for image like PixelCNN. So there are also other techniques following this line of research, like free bits. We can constrain the minimum value of the KL divergence. Like if the KL divergence is lower than the threshold we specified, then we will not optimize this KL divergence. So the second solution is weakening the decoder. So the posterior collapse problem will become more common and serious when the model is equipped with a powerful decoder, especially the autoregressive decoder. So the decoder can rely on its history itself to generate the outputs instead of looking at the latent representation Z. So a straightforward idea is weaken the decoder to make it rely on the latent variables. And it is shown in the Chen et al.'s paper in 2017 that the decoder, if the decoder don't have to rely on the latent representation and can generate the outputs on itself, then the best solution for it is to ignore the latent variables. Because the goal of variational autoencoding is to maximize the variational lower bound, so Junxin has introduced. So when the lower bound achieves, the model just assigns the approximate posterior equal to the true model posterior, and which is also equal to the prior of the model, which is just a simple Gaussian distribution. And this simple Gaussian distribution makes the latent variable Z disconnected with the input X. And we can weaken the decoder to force it rely on the latent variable Z instead of relying on the history of its own. So what we can do is an early solution for this is to use word dropout. We can randomly drop out word input in an LSTM decoder to make the decoder weaker. And a second solution is, instead of using a fully autoregressive neuron decoder, we can use a non-autoregressive one, such as the work proposed in Zichao from CMU, which uses a dilated convolutional decoder with limited context instead of RNN, which looks at the whole history of the output. So the second solution is proposed by Junxian from his excellent iClear work this year. So he proposes a very succinct solution to solve this problem. Note the previous solution that had been posed either modified the objective function, like if you constrain the weight of the KL divergence, you have already modified the objective function we want to optimize, which is the maximum log likelihood. And the second solution, which changes the model architecture, because we still want a powerful decoder, but we want this powerful decoder to depend on the latent representations as well. And Junxian proposes a succinct solution that does not need to change either the objective function or change the model architecture, and which also while being extremely fast. So the solution is a two-step optimization. So he proposes this from a perspective of training dynamics. So inside this max-max objective, we first optimize the parameters for the inference network, which is the encoder phi. And so we aggressively optimize the inference network parameters to make it catch up with the true model posterior. And then outside the second max operation, we have another max objective, which maximizes the variational lower bound by learning the updated inference network parameter first. So next I will talk about handling discrete latent variables. So there are many cases that we will encounter discrete latent variables, such as we want to know the part of speech of a word, we want to know the question of a class, and we need to know the retrace, like in an OCR application, you want to, the latent variable might be the writer uses the left hand or the right hand when he's writing. And there are also other examples, like we want to control the sentiment of a text, of the output text. So how do we handle these cases when we have like discrete latent variables? So the first method is very straightforward. So if we have a discrete latent variable and the search space for it is very small, so there are only like limited search space for this latent variable, we can just enumerate all the possibilities of the configuration of these discrete latent variables, such as if there are only like five sentiments, which is very good, or indifferent, or bad, or very bad, and we can have these five different sentiments and enumerate all of them to calculate the true marginal log likelihood, and then directly optimize this marginal log likelihood. But when the search space of the discrete variables is very large, such as when we have a large vocabulary in the sequence-to-sequence model, like machine translation, or we have a structure prediction problem, we have exponential spaces to sample to enumerate from. So we cannot do enumeration at this time because it's too costly. And what we can do is, alternatively, sample a small subset of configurations from this subspace. And with respect to this subset, we can choose a proper training objective that suits our problem, like minimum risk training objective or the maximum elbow loss. So elbow loss is a variational lower bound introduced by Jin Xian previously. However, there is still one problem. How do we backpropagate gradients with respect to these discrete samples? So the gradient still cannot backpropagate it. So the solution is we can use the method we learned in our previous class in the reinforcement learning introduced by Graham. So we can use policy gradients method. So the core of policy gradient methods is the scope function gradient estimator that we can estimate the gradients by sampling like a subset of samples from the policy. And this estimator is unbiased but has very high variance because you can encounter different samples. And we need some solutions to reduce the variance by introduce some variance control variate. So for more details, I do recommend you to look at our materials in reinforcement learning class. And here I want to correct a point Jun Xian just talked about. So he introduced the reparameterization trick for continuous latent variables. However, he said it might not be feasible to come up with a reparameterization trick for the discrete latent variables. So it's not the case. So in 2017, so two papers come concurrently to solve this problem. They propose a reparameterization trick for discrete latent variables, which is called Gumball softmax. So when we have a discrete latent variable, our original distribution is a categorical distribution, and this technique is based on a Gumball max trick, which proposes a simple way to sample from a categorical distribution. Here, the categorical distribution is denoted as PZ given X. So if we have this categorical distribution, this Gumball max trick can generate such the samples from the categorical distribution by using the argmax operation. And with a noise Gumball from a Gumball distribution. So you can think of the Gumball distribution as a standard Gaussian distribution we used for the continuous case. So where in the continuous case, we use noises from the standard Gaussian distribution as the noise. And for the discrete latent variables, we use the noise from a Gumball DIR1 distribution as the noises for the reparameterization trick. So the Gumball DIR1 distribution is defined in this form. However, as you can see, there is still an argmax operation. And this argmax operation is not differentiable, and we can still not do backprop. So what Gumball softmax does is to relax these hard decisions and make a continuous approximation to these discrete samples. So what this paper does is to replace the hard decision argmax with a softmax with temperature tau. And when tau approaches zero, this approximation is accurate. And when tau is greater than zero, the approximation might not be that accurate, but it's a smooth function. And we can backpropagate through the softmax parameters. So the noises, the sampling procedure comes from this Gumball noise. I definitely will recommend you to read the original paper of Gumball softmax published in iClear 2017 to learn more details about it. So it's a very popular and strategy of dealing with discrete latent variables in natural language processing. So next, I will talk about some applications of variational inference in VAE, or in natural language processing. So the first work is from Miao, 2016, which is a neural variational inference for text processing. So this work applies VAE in two NLP tasks. One is document modeling, and the other is question answering. So for document modeling, it introduces a continuous latent variable H for each document, for each observed document, and optimizes the marginal, the variational lower bound on the log likelihood of observed documents. And for the question answering task, it introduces a latent variable, the latent variables for that condition on both the questions and the answers, where attention. And this model is maximizes the conditional, the variational lower bound on the conditional log likelihood of a relatedness given a question and answer. So the output is the relatedness of a question answer pair. So there are some like intuitions discussed in this paper. So why we want to use the latent variable model for text modeling. So the basic intuition is that so the model can the latent distributions can grant the model the abilities of summing over all the possibilities in terms of the semantics. And the second intuition is so the Bayesian learning framework can prevent the model from overfitting. So the next work is from Hu Zhiting in CMU. So it's a very early work in controllable text generation and style transfer. So I think this work is a very action work. So this work contains two latent variables. So the first is a content latent variable, which represents the content of the input text. And the second latent variable, C, represents the style, like sentiment, or like positive or negative of your input sequence. And the goal is to output another sequence based on the content of the input text and the specified style. So you can notice that there are two very good and intuitive laws. So the first one is the blue line, so which minimizes the distance between the latent code generated by conditioning on the true input and the latent code generated based on the output text. So it's like a cycle loss to guarantee that the output sequence returns the same content as the input sequence. And the second loss is the black line in the bottom, which adds another classification loss on the generated output. So this loss guarantees that the model can output the context, a sequence that satisfied your specified style. So both of these two latent codes are continuous variables and have the Gaussian standard Gaussian as its their prior. So this work is from me and Graham. So we propose a semi-supervised framework for sequence-to-sequence transduction. So we also have two types of latent variables. One is a continuous latent variable, and the other is discrete latent variables. We apply this model to morphological reinflection, where you are given a word, a source word like play, and you are given a sequence of target labels, such as the post tagging is past tense, and the tense is past tense, and the post tagging is the post tag is still verb, and you want to output played in this case. And so this task is to output the desired target sequence given a source sequence and the target labels. So we treat the we have the continuous representation that we want it to represent the lemma of a word, like the word of place, the lemma of place is play, and we want the target labels. We treat the target labels as our latent, discrete latent variables. And during training, so this is a semi-supervised work. So during training, for the supervised data, we can have a classification. We can add a classification loss on the target labels. And for unlabeled data, where we don't have those gold labels, we can make inference on those discrete labels. And our prior for these discrete labels are just a uniform distribution, because they are categorical distributions. And so the output, the decoder conditions both on the continuous latent variable and the discrete label variables. And this work is also comes from our group by Peng Cheng, me, Junxin, and Grant. So this work, we propose a semi-supervised work, a framework for semantic parsing. And we also employ discrete latent variables, which is a tree structure of the query, of the semantic query. So for supervised data, given a supervised data, we have the golden tree structure and the query. We can train the encoder by supervised with the query and the golden tree structure. And for unlabeled data, we have no access to the golden tree, and we just make inference on this on the tree structure. So the prior of our discrete tree structure is a language model on the linearized tree of the pattern tree. And so we have that prior to regularize our model to output correct tree structure for unseen input query. So this work, this model works pretty well mm-hmm. when we have only access to very limited of supervised data. So the last work I want to introduce is also related to discrete latent variables. So this work is called Language as a Latent Variable, so by Miao in 2016. So it applies WayE to the task of summarization. And this model have the discrete latent variables that represents the compression of text, which is a summarization of text. And so again, these discrete latent variables cannot be trained because we sample from the posterior model, the encoder, and this discrete latent variables cannot be used to backpropagate. So we use we employ the same technique as in this paper. So we employ the scale function gradient estimator to estimate the gradients, which is a polished gradient we have introduced before. So this model also uses the scale function gradient estimator to optimize the variational lower bounds on the observed sentences. And the model uses this inference network, the encoder, to generate the summarization of a given given text. And we can imagine that the prior for this compression codes with the latent variables is a pre-trained language model on the short sentences, which are the summarizations we already have. So the model can be encouraged to output like shorter sentences. which summarizes the in sentences, and the decoder itself reconstructs it back to the original sentences. Similar ideas can also be used to discover language in a setting of multi-agents communication. So that's all. Any questions? It's pretty early, so I guess our class is over.